I had that truly rare privilege of being with the Apollo 11 astronauts on the morning they left Earth for their historic journey to the moon. And to add to my personal euphoria of that moment, I knew they were carrying with them to the surface of the moon the original engravings that were to be used to print the first man on the moon stamp which I designed.
Space pod clear. Roger. Coming. Now step off the land now. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Not every artist has sold over 150 billion copies of one of his drawings, nor been present at space launchings and splashdowns. In 1962, 7 years before that Apollo vessel was launched here, Paul Kelly was one of the leading American artists invited by NASA to document the space program. His unique portrayals of the men and events of space exploration are now on view in the National Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C. Stunning glimpses of Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo missions. It brought him privileged opportunities and set him in the tradition of those earlier artists who had recorded the great voyages of exploration in the past.
Space exploration, the Western experience, time and worlds apart are really part of the heritage of mankind. And I just feel that they have to be set down and paint, and that seems to be the direction that I'm going in, and I just feel that it's historically important. Documenting the achievements of man, his conquest of space in the 60s and the 70s, or my recent work of the journey back in time to portray the trappers and the mountain men of the 1800s.
No one is better suited to record and interpret history, recent or past. A passion for authentic detail, an eye for the dramatic, an exuberant sense of the individual and of adventure. All of these, Paul Kelly brings to his work. There's a vibrancy in a Kelly work that's more than the power of color or the reality of surface texture. It comes in part from Paul's belief that drawing is just as important as painting. His brush strokes, like his pencil strokes, bristle with energy. But the major sources of vitality in these works are the artist's own zestful enthusiasm for his subject matter and the meticulous research that underlies every detail. This is Paul's studio in rural Connecticut, the restored hayloft of an old barn. His collection of artifacts and reference materials grew too large for his original studio at home in nearby Stamford. He now works here, surrounded by this storehouse of historical objects from America's Old West. Many of the items are the real thing. Some are authentically detailed reproductions. All of them are sources of the historical accuracy that characterizes Kelly's work. They're also models for visual accuracy, showing exactly how light plays over their surfaces to bring color and texture alive, giving the artist the opportunity to use his skills to capture reality. Paul Kelly's skills have been honed by training at the Pratt Institute in New York, his hometown, and by years as an illustrator for the country's leading magazines. He's designed over a dozen stamps, including the first twin space stamp issued in the United States, a portrayal of the first American spacewalk in 1967. This is where the artist must think big, but draw small. His book, The Pencil, is the definitive work on the technique of pencil drawing. No one is better qualified to have written it. Paul still keeps the pencil stubs from a decade of drawings, including the full-sized penciled versions he does of every painting. He prefers a soft lead, HB. But what he achieves with the almost exclusive use of that one kind is astounding. An enormous range of tones and textures, and a growing stock of used-up pencils. Paul usually starts work briskly at 8:30 in the morning, and most weekdays are 10-hour days, which is long for an artist. He enjoys the solitude of his studio. It's a retreat from distractions, set well back from the road, no mailbox to betray his presence, with windows that provide natural light, and the occasional muffled sound from the horses stabled below. Here he can recreate other places, other times. He can chronicle the history he loves.
To me, there's always been a similarity, a oneness between that booted foot of Neil Armstrong sinking into the dust of the moon and the moccasin foot of mountain men like John Coulter sinking into the snow of the Yellowstone River Valley. They were both establishing a new frontier at the edge of each new footstep, and I've always been happy that I've been able to share events with people through my work.
Paul Kelly's fascination with the old frontier was sparked in the 1960s. Then he was made chairman of the federal government's Artists in the Parks program. He traveled extensively throughout the national park system in the West, including here at Yellowstone. His imagination was completely captured by the magnificence all around. It was only 175 years ago that this area was unknown to all but the occasional band of Indians. Then in 1807, a former member of the Lewis and Clark expedition set off on his own and became the first white man to see this extraordinary landscape. He was a Virginian named John Coulter. He spent a winter here, trapping and exploring. And on his return to the East, people could hardly credit his descriptions of all the geysers and hot springs that kept rivers from freezing over and filled the frigid winter air with clouds of steam. Other trappers added to the tales of volcanic wonders. And over the next few decades, the government mounted official expeditions to check out the area. Finally, the East was persuaded that this was indeed an astounding and unique terrain. In 1872, legislation was passed to set aside over 2 million acres for the enjoyment of future generations. Yellowstone became the first of America's great national parks. And then almost a century later, the Artists in the Parks program began to record the natural wonders and the history of these priceless tracts of land. For Paul Kelly, the program was a turning point. It opened to him not only the scenic vistas of his country, but also the doors to a past filled with courage, color, and individuality. Just as today's traveler can discover for himself what the early explorers wondered at, the viewer of a Calais canvas can recapture the seasons in the lives of the mountain men. This is what first brought the mountain men west, the beaver, with its marketable fur. They'd spend the winter and the early spring in the wilderness, trapping. And then in the summer, there would be the great rendezvous, the meeting with traders from the east, bringing supplies to be bartered for the winter's catch. The first rendezvous on record took place in a valley just beyond these Wyoming mountains, the Grand Tetons, whose peaks rise into the sky 7,000 feet above the flatlands. The Tetons lie just south of Yellowstone and became a national park in 1929. Nearby land was formerly owned by the Rockefeller family. It became a public resource in 1943 and was added to the park in 1950. Animal species that sustained the fur trade and the fur trappers can still be found in this magnificent wilderness retreat. Moose meat saw many a mountain man through the bitter winters of this high northwestern land. And here in Montana, also once the domain of the trapper and the trader, another gathering has assembled, the Northwest Rendezvous Group. One of its founding members is Paul Kelly. This annual meeting has been taking place since 1979 and brings artists from all over the states and Canada to see the land and its modern mountain men. Here, artists have access to other enthusiasts of a West that no longer exists, people whose hobbies or whose work must involve historical knowledge, people with authentically realistic costumes and artifacts who can revive the past in a stunning setting. This is what a 19th century beaver trap looked like and how it was set. Now Paul can find the details he needs. And here, in the actual locale of the history he cherishes, he can use his remarkable sketching abilities to capture not only the historical truth of his subject matter, but its emotional truth as well. Its mood, its wilderness atmosphere, as it is today and as it was before. It's no wonder this rendezvous draws so many. The artists aren't the only ones to look forward so eagerly to this gathering. For many of the people who assemble here, it's an important social occasion, as well as a chance to exchange news and ideas. Many of them have chosen to recapture the past in their year-round lives, to live simply, away from cities, to earn a living in one of the old ways. They're not just models. Many are craftsmen, skilled at leatherwork, saddle making, bead and quill work, or scrimshaw, the carving of bone or antlers. Sharing their skills and their enthusiasms with the artists they meet is one of the highlights of the year. The rendezvous also gives the artists an opportunity to gain insights into the lives of the Indians, how they hunted, what they made and used, how they reacted to the takeover of their territory, to the disappearance of the buffalo, the coming of the settlers. These are the words of one of the chiefs. "You ask me to plow the ground. Shall I take a knife and tear my mother's bosom? You ask me to dig for stone. Shall I dig under her skin for bones? You ask me to cut grass and make hay and sell it to be rich like white men. But how dare I cut my mother's hair? The land will last forever, and through all the years it will give life to men and beasts. We cannot sell the lives of men and animals, and therefore we cannot sell the land. It was put here by the Great Spirit, and we cannot sell it because it does not belong to us. You can count your money, but only the Great Spirit can count the grains of sand and the blades of grass on these plains. As a present to you, we will give you anything we have that you can take with you. The land we cannot give." These are the feelings Paul Kelly manages to express in his paintings, as vividly and accurately as the detailed lore he gathers at the rendezvous.
The bed place.
Dan, let me ask you about the significance of your pipe and the skull.
That's like my personal medicine. And same with the buffalo skull. It's a sage. The sage kind of purifies the inside of the lodge, and it's supposed to keep bad spirits and the bad feelings and that out.
What is the significance now of the pipe and the skull in the teepee, your setup? Okay. Is that Sioux, Northern Plains?
That's a personal belief. The pipe is actually like an altar. The four bands on the bowl represent the four winds.
And the seven?
The seven were for the seven bands, the seven Sioux bands. Actually, when you get into that, you get into seven major Sioux bands and several sub-tribes.
So it would be the Sioux Nation? Is that what it would be significant? Seven great Sioux Nations?
Yeah, it's called the Great Sioux Nation.
Yeah. For the mountain man who adapted to the Indian way, would it be a personal interpretation of the of the mountain man in the Indian culture?
The placement of the pipe in the lodge is usually like this.
Mm-hmm.
And if it isn't out like this, the bowl will be put away in a pipe bag like this one.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And this one was given to me by a Chippewa Sioux Indian. In fact, it was just given to me about a month ago.
Now, how would it change in a completely Indian teepee?
It's hard to say. The pipe would, for the most part.
Paul's sketchbook is one of his most vital pieces of equipment. Whether he's working in pencil or in pen and ink, what he records on paper becomes invaluable reference material. Graphic notes that may form the germ of a painting that will grow and develop back home in the studio. He also uses the camera as a sketchbook, especially for moving subjects, wildlife, or the shifting shadows in a landscape. The camera can also record for him the details in close-up of any element within a scene. But above all, his greatest asset is his artist's eye, seeing in its own way and eventually giving us a chance to see more, to see differently. A long, thoughtful process lies between what the artist originally sees or imagines and what he finally paints. Research, planning, deciding what to include and what to leave out, how to place the figures within the frame, how to balance tones and colors. Paul pre-mixes his paints, having decided beforehand the range of pigment combinations he'll use. For each painting, he also does a full-sized pencil drawing. This he calls solving problems on paper, rather than in paint. His mastery of the pencil and his large, detailed sketches let him finalize composition, textures, and tones of light and shade, all before he ever dips a brush into paint. He developed this approach early on when he was still working as a commercial artist. He found that sometimes presenting a small, rough sketch to a client brought disappointment or disagreement once the final work was viewed. Even with his preliminary pencil work and his pre-mixed colors, Paul still likes to achieve some effects by working directly from the real thing. Especially when he wants to capture the look of something as particular as the thick layering of plumage on a Canada goose. Looking at his painting, you can almost feel the weight of the birds, as well as the soft lightness of their feathers. Reality leaps towards the eye with a wizardry that comes only with years of experience, and that's available only to an artist of Paul Kelly's caliber. For the artist concerned with realism, nothing is more valuable or more stimulating than a field trip. Here in the Canadian Rockies, Paul visits Canada's first national park, Banff. Like Yellowstone, it first drew attention because of its hot springs, which provided wilderness bathtubs for workers on the CPR, the nation's first transcontinental railroad. Here, Paul is joined by his wife, Olga. They were childhood sweethearts and have been partners in the raising of their three children as well as in the production of countless works of art. Olga's an expert researcher, providing her husband with much of his vital reference material. His book is dedicated to Olga, who shares the dreams and realities and believes.
Isn't it fantastic? Absolutely. Absolutely awesome. Perfect situation for return to camp. Just absolutely beautiful in there. I could see that red capote like it was here right now.
And then a campfire right there.
It would be perfect. It would be a perfect situation.
Paul Kelly is an artist who opens our eyes and lets us see what is, what was, what might have been. He combines acute observation with imagination, a respect for authenticity with an active and abiding affection for the achievements of nature and of humanity. In his book, The Pencil, Paul sums up his purposes as an artist with these words.
I think for me, if I had to state a goal, a hope pertaining to my work, my aim would be to help keep alive that huge reservoir of our past, to draw strength and sustenance from it, to build upon it in ways that are new and different, but not to reject it. I find my inspiration in all the life that surrounds and envelops me. From the evolution of man and his works, the timelessness of the rocks, the trees, of man, his land, the sky and the sea. This is my world and I relish it with great affection.
Paul Kelly's world is our world. In order to love it and preserve it, we must first see it. The views we are afforded in the works of this fine artist are, in every sense, revelations.